Thank you. As I was introduced, my name is Father Leonce, Rambau, CSSp, and I'm here to present a topic on Paul and Phoebe in Romans 16, verse 1 to 2, collaborative ministry and the role of women in ancient Christianity. This presentation was part of my doctoral research. In his missionary work, Paul relied heavily on a long list of associates with whom he collaborated in his travels, evangelization, and founding of local churches. Paul never worked alone. These associates included both men and women, Gentile and Jewish Christians, people of high and low status in the society, including one slave. One of such individuals is a woman named Phoebe, who is mentioned in Romans 16, verse 1 to 2. Based on this text, this presentation aims at studying the nature of Paul's collaborative ministry in his missionary activities and the role of women in such collaboration. This presentation will examine how Paul designates Phoebe in order to demonstrate the nature of such collaboration and the role that women played in Paul's collaborative missionary activity. I'll begin by reading Romans 16, verse 1 to 2. I commend to you our sister Phoebe, a deacon of the church at St. Craig, so that you may welcome her in the Lord as it is fitting for the saints, and help her in whatever she may require from you. For she has been a benefactor of many and of myself as well. End of the text. Phoebe appears only in this particular text. And this text is a letter of recommendation of this particular woman named Phoebe from a town of James Ray. And she's presented as our sister, and an intermediary or a deacon, and a patron. The purpose of such a letter of recommendation was for her to be received by the Christian community at Rome. It was a request for hospitality and assistance from Paul on her behalf from the Church of Rome. Her name, Phoebe, suggests a pagan background and probably indicates her status as a free woman. Paul presents her as our sister and as an intermediary, diaconess, and as a patron, prostatis. Her hometown of St. Clair was a harbor and an urban center during the imperial period based on archaeological evidence. Since archaeological evidence have not come up with any evidence that there was a Christian church in this city, probably the church which is referred in this text was hosted in Phoebe's house. In this text, Phoebe is not introduced in terms of her family relations, which was common in the Greco-Roman world, but in terms of her ecclesiastical functions and relationships. Her credentials, as presented in these three titles, imply that she played some form of leadership in this particular Christian community. The first of the attributes that Paul attributes to her is sister, Adelphi. In Pauline letters, kinship terms of Adelphos, Adelphi, that's the Greek for brother, sister, occurs several times in all his letters. Paul specifically uses these terms to refer to the missionary, to his missionary associates. He also uses these terms to refer to all the Christian community members. These terms, the terms, are a translation of the Hebrew Bible's ah, or ahot, and its derivative, kahawah, which translates brother, sister, brothers, sisters, and brotherhood. And these terms have a wide range of meanings also in the Hebrew Bible. Primarily refers to a person's own blood, someone's brother or sister, a sibling from the same mother, from the same father. The terms are also used to refer to half-brothers, half-sisters, people related by blood, such as nephews, kinsmen, or when one tribe is speaking about the other tribe, the people of Israel. Other references include a brother by choice, or a companion, a fellow country person, a fellow Israelite, or simply a companion. Therefore, in the Hebrew Bible, the term is used to refer to either actual blood relationship, as well as real but fictive kinship relationship, as a metaphorical use of this term. In this later usage, the metaphorical or fictive kinship usage, the emphasis is on solidarity, affection, similarity, and equality of rights. As one scholar puts it, in its very context, this term reflects the existence of or a desire for a sibling-like bond between the speaker and the addressee. In Paul's letters, the metaphorical use of kinship language with brotherhood and sisterhood is closely used with other familiar and household terms to construct the identity of the Christian community and the relationships therein. Collectively, they designate a fictive kinship language. And this is Paul's key designation of the members of his congregation. Paul uses the term referring to the congregation to whom he writes, and to specific and non-specific individuals throughout his letters. Overall, Paul refers to this term 112 times in reference to Christian believers. As another scholar puts it, the promise of this kinship description would seem to imply that Paul both assumes and promotes the relationship between himself and his addressees, among the addressees themselves, as one between equal siblings who share a sense of affection, mutual responsibility, and solidarity. Paul also uses the term to articulate the fellowship of communion, relationship between himself and his associates, including Phoebe, on account of their common and shared activities on behalf of the gospel. When Paul describes any of his associates as my brother or sister, he refers not only to their common Christian faith, but also to their shared experiences, goals, and common commitment to the gospel. This usage shows a fictive but real relationship, which is brought about by a Christian faith, shared experiences in proclamation of the gospel, and mutual affection. This is a specialized meaning in Paul. Paul's use of the kinship language to articulate Christian self-understanding and social relationships is very significant. As one scholar put it, Paul uses sibling language to promote solidarity and mutual regard among members of his congregation. His emphatic use of such language when confronted by situations in which there is currently a lack of such concern indicates that he sees sibling bonds as implying precisely the mutualism which he seeks to foster. And so this language is fundamentally egalitarian. It demonstrates the nature of the fellowship that is described by another theological term, which is his favorite, koinonia. It qualifies the basic unity and oneness in Christ that is brought about by baptism into Christ. Christians are one because they have a fellowship through a common participation in Christ, in the faith, through the Spirit and common participation in the gospel preaching. This fellowship forms a special bond akin to that of blood siblingship. The same applies to fellowship and communion, and common participation applies to Paul and his associates, including Phoebe, whom he addressed my sister. Paul sees Phoebe as a full participant in the missionary endeavor, integral part of his missionary commitment, since they all share the common fellowship in the gospel. Paul also designates Phoebe as diaconess, or a deacon. This term is another one of the most commonly used terms in the New Testament in reference to the missionary activity and the gospel preaching. Paul uses the covenant word cluster, diaconos, diaconeo, and diaconia. This is a deacon, deaconate ministry, and the ministry served. This to describe the nature of his mission and that of his associates. Paul specifically applies the term diaconos to Apollos, Stephanas, Phoebe, Timothy, and the verb diaconeo is generally translated as to serve, while the abstract noun diakonia is generally translated as a service or office. The noun diakonos denotes the person who carries out the activities meant for diakoneo and is generally translated as a servant. Over the years, the word pastor was understood in the context of table service. Thus, even in secular Greek, the verb was translated as to wait at on tables, or to care for one's livelihood, or to serve in general. This understanding is reflected in one scholar, Alphonse Weiser, who explains as follows. Diaconeo and its covenants express express much more strongly the idea of service on behalf of someone, and become in certain strata of the New Testament a central expression for Christian functions in the church, charitable activity, proclamation of the word, and the task of leadership. Recently, however, based on one calling analysis of the Greek background of the term diakonos in the wider non-Christian sources, he came up with the findings that the term is understood to have a general sense of a go-between person, a courier, or a carrier of a message, or agents who transmit something on or effect some deed, or attendants in the household, like at table. Given this new finding, even the new translation of the definition of the term in the Greek English lexicon, diakonos is translated as follows: one who serves as an intermediary in a transaction, an agent, an intermediary, or a courier. Second, one who gets something done at the behest of a superior, an assistant. Based on this definition, in secular Greek, the term generally denotes a go-between person, either in commerce or in civic life, or an intermediary between gods and humans. The New Testament usage, however, is very diverse. The entire range of meanings, as I just mentioned, is reflected therein. In some instances, the word cluster refers to serving a table, especially in the Synoptic Gospels and Acts. In other instances, it refers to a caring help or service, again in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Synoptic Gospels. In other instances, Jesus' entire ministry and his death on the cross on behalf of the humanity is described as diakoni, the ministry of a deacon, especially in Mark and Luke. Additionally, Christian discipleship, following Christ, having faith in Christ, is diakonia, again in Matthew and Mark. as well as the entire Christian missionary endeavor by the messengers of the gospel, the preachers of the gospel, proclamation of the gospel, the missionary activity is construed as diakone, especially in Acts 1:17 and 6:4. So Paul employs the word cluster to describe his ministry on behalf of the gospel, especially in the Romans and 1 Corinthians, including the ministry carried out by the false apostles as well. Paul describes and dismisses the ministry of some of his co-workers, his associates, as diakonia as well. And in this instance, Phoebe is one of his associates, as we have read in Romans 16, verse 1. Paul describes his missionary activity and that of his co-workers, and he describes himself and his co-workers as diakonos, deacons. Paul and his co-workers are deacons because they act as intermediaries of the gospel and because they are at the service of the gospel. His self-understanding and his understanding of his ministry, the ministry of his associates and other ministries in the churches, are rooted in the early Christian understanding of Jesus' ministry and his death as diakonia on behalf of humanity, service on behalf of humanity. According to another scholar, Paul sees himself in a double relationship of service with respect both to Christ and to the church. In the essence of his apostolic service, Paul regards the proclamation of the gospel as the fundamental and central activity. So the term underlines the centrality of the gospel in the missionary endeavors. In Romans 16:1, Paul describes Phoebe as diakonos, referring to her role in her church. It has been argued that this role resembles some form of an office, just like the office of apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Nevertheless, such resemblance is too early. This development is apparent in the pastoral epistles, the later epistles in the New Testament, and probably also in Philippians 1:1. It means that an office of deacon is implied in these pastoral epistles, but not in Paul in Romans. As one scholar puts it, Phoebe is a minister, a local leader of the church at St. Clair, exercising some leadership role in her church. Paul, however, uses this term to describe his own identity and identity of his co-workers. So even Paul's usage of the term, the meaning here should be taken to be the same as elsewhere in Paul's letters, referring to someone who is fully at the service of the gospel. Phoebe goes on an embassy on behalf of her congregation, and she is a benefactor of the Christian community, just like other Paul's associates like Stephanas, Prisca and Aquila, Philemon, Sosthenes, among others. Paul here emphasized that himself and Phoebe are mere agents, intermediaries, functionaries of the gospel, and all of them partake in the ministry of in a collaborative way. Paul uses this designation to emphasize a proper attitude towards the missionary work. That is, the focus should not be on the agents of evangelization themselves, but rather on the message itself. Therefore, Phoebe, a Christian woman, travels to Rome on behalf of her church, though her mission on behalf of her community is not spelled out. She is presented as working for the gospel without a specific partner, like Prisca and Aquila, or Eudia and Syntyche. Nevertheless, she played an important role in her community, so she officially represents her community to the Church of Rome. It is also most likely she was the carrier of the letter to the Romans, which Paul wrote while he was at Corinth near St. Clair, since the person who was recommended in the letter was always, in most cases, the carrier of that same letter. If this is the case, she might have acted as Paul's envoy as well, to Rome as well. Paul recommends that Phoebe should be accorded a Christian welcome and hospitality at Rome, and that she should be assisted in whatever she needs, since this is how Christians, the saints, are expected to act. Paul here implies that she will receive a welcoming hospitality, including lodging and assistance. In describing this assistance and welcoming, Paul uses a phrase that appears only here in the New Testament, hapax legomena. Ho an humane, presde pragmatic, does Greek for whatever she might need in the matter. This phrase occurs only here in the entire Greek literature even. It implies an open-ended request for aid. The meaning of this phrase has to do with the purpose of Paul's writing the letter to the Romans. The text refers to the matter of Phoebe's patronage, implying her employment of substantial resources on behalf of her church and on behalf of Paul. Paul points out that Phoebe has benefited many, including him. Therefore, this beneficence should be reciprocated. And this brings us to the third attribute of Phoebe, a patron. Beneficence and gratitude are features of a Roman social system of patronage. Therefore, Paul designates Phoebe as prostatis, which is a feminine form of prostates, which in Latin is patronus, and has been generally translated in many English translations as helper, a supporter. However, this rendering has been thoroughly debunked because it is misleading at best. The term can be defined as a leader, a president, a superintendent, or a patron. And therefore, in this particular context, the meaning should be taken as the same meaning which is found in secular Greek, that Phoebe is patron and a benefactor. And current scholarship understands this to be the correct rendering of Phoebe's designation. Patronage was a social system of relationship that involved reciprocal exchange of services between patrons and clients. This relationship was a voluntary personal and personal, and it was an equal, asymmetrical relationship in terms of social status. And the terms of this relationship were entirely dictated by the superior part of the relationship. Through this relationship, power, influence, social status, and the flow of material resources were brokered. So patronage was a means of generating, monopolizing and distributing both economic, political, and social power based on an equal relationship. In this relationship, status, honor, and benefits and drafting were central. Although this system existed to some extent in the classical Greek cities, it was not very common. But we have few instances in Greek, and this situation changed after the emergence of the Roman Empire at the beginning of the millennium, the first millennium, and the power vacuum accompanying it. Therefore, this institution became more prominent outside Rome, especially the Roman colonies. And the most common form of patronage was public sponsorship, public patronage of private groups. Typically, most of the patrons were men of high social status, because this was a public institution, and in the Greco-Roman world, women were always confined to the private household, and men were confined or were extended their influence in the public place. Nevertheless, despite this being a mainly male institution, social and political patronage by elite women started to spread in the East and in the West in the first and second century. Evidence in papyrus, for example, dating back to 142 BC, shows us several instances of women who become patrons. In many Roman inscriptions, a fifth of the names are women patrons who acted as protectors and donors to private associations. These inscriptions show elite women, or even non-elite women, exercising both personal and group sponsorship of people in the Roman world. One scholar puts it, in the Roman social system, as distinct from the other Greek ways, status took precedence over gender as a matter of prestige and power. A person of higher social status had access to power and could function as a mediator and dispenser of favors regardless of sex, with the same expectations of reciprocity in terms of honor, praise, and loyalty on the part of the clients. In early Christianity, patronage consisted of exchanging of hospitality and hosting of Christian gatherings. As we know, in the first few decades of early Christianity, Christians met in private houses to pray and to worship and to listen to the word of God and to celebrate sacraments like baptism and the Eucharist. So material exchange would include material and cash gifts, food and dinner invitations, lodging and recommendation. In Christian house churches, scholars now see that the model of social networks based on informal and asymmetrical relationships for the exchange of goods and resources is the social reality underlying the relationships that created the early Christian communities. In the Greco-Roman world, a person who was a patron held a significant prominence and prestige in the community. Such a person acted as a sponsor and benefited both private individuals and private associations. Looked out for their interests, defended them, and acted as their guardian. Possibly Phoebe was responsible for her own estate and household, which enabled her to bestow benefits on the church and on Paul. The text of Romans 16:2 implies that Phoebe hosted a house church by designating her as a patron and as a diaconess. Additionally, archaeological excavation at this particular site, St. Clair, has not found any building specifically designated for worship in the first century. And most probably the church at St. Clair met at Phoebe's house. And in this household church, the household hostess of the house churches was usually a person of high social standing and means who presided over the Eucharistic celebration and was responsible for the ordering of the congregation. Given this evidence, one scholar argues, Phoebe had agreed to underwrite a project of vital significance to Paul and to the letter he was writing. The Roman recipients of the letter, that's the letter of the Romans, would understand her to be recommended as the patroness of the Spanish mission which Paul had announced in the letter of the Romans. As a missionary patroness of many, and therefore a person of substantial wealth, the churches of Rome would have no fear that cooperation with her would require onerous involvement with a person of high social status. Her patronage would involve gaining the cooperation of the Roman house churches in creating the logistic base and arranging for the translators who will be required for Paul's Spanish mission. Another indication that Phoebe was a patron is Paul's emphasis on reciprocity, which was the key characteristic feature of patronage. Paul recommends that Phoebe should be assisted because she herself has benefited many, including Paul. Paul recognizes Phoebe's status and role in the society. As a patron, Phoebe bestowed benefits to her church at St. Clair and to the traveling missionaries like Paul. So Paul says, because of this, as one other scholar puts it, Phoebe patronage was not limited to the community of St. Clair, but included many others, even Paul himself, who stood with her in a patron-client relationship. Therefore, Paul asked the community of Rome to repay Phoebe, to show reciprocity according to the exchange law of the Greco-Roman patronage, the assistance and favors which Paul and other Christians owed her as her client. As Phoebe's client, Paul was the recipient of benefaction from her. Paul and others were socially dependent on her, socially and economically. She extended generous benefits to Christian groups, such as offering hospitality, hosting meetings, providing material and financial support to the household charges, and issuing recommendations. These were typical benefits expected when one acted as a patron of a group. As a woman of means, she probably owned the house, and she played an active role, as she is designated diaconess, in the life of the congregation at St. Clair, including traveling on behalf of this Christian group to Rome. But despite this patronal relationship and dependency, Paul's relationship with Phoebe is primarily articulated in egalitarian terms, as both share a fellowship, a communion, through a common participation in the gospel. They are brothers and sisters in Christ, and they have a common participation in the missionary work. Therefore, they share a diaconia of the gospel. So, I'm going to offer a short conclusion and draw a few implications for this study. This study has demonstrated that the nature of Paul's mission work was essentially collaborative. Such collaboration was grounded on the common participation in one faith brought about by baptism and a single-minded commitment to the service on behalf of the gospel. The centrality of the gospel and its mandate brought about a bond, a communion, a common participation among all the actors, including women like Phoebe. Phoebe appears to be functioning just like other missionary associates of Paul. She plays also a very significant socio-economical role of sponsorship of churches and individual missionaries like Paul, roles which were typically reserved for men of higher social classes. Therefore, the way St. Paul understood the gospel and its commitment and the mandate to spread it led him to construe the identity of a missionary which transcended some of the constraints of the Greco-Roman social relationships, such as mixing between Jewish people and the Gentiles, and in this particular case, the separation between men and women, the designation of men in the public square, and relegation of women in the private square. Therefore, as Paul carried out his ministry and related to his associates, including Phoebe, he revealed how he portrays a new Christian identity in which all are one. Through baptism, all are one. And having been covered by Christ, there is no Greek or Jew, there is no slave or free, male or female. as we read in Galatians 3:28. Thank you. Now just one remark regarding the significance of this study for the contemporary Christian living. Paul saw that the gospel has the power to transform people into one, to create an actual relationship between people of different designations, different backgrounds, languages, ethnicities, and religions. He saw that the power of the gospel has the ability to create a real bond, which is similar to the relationship of a brother and a sister. That's why he emphasized that all Christians are brothers and sisters. And therefore, our churches have the similar challenge as our societies become more and more diverse and people come together because of the development of means of transport and globalization. It is urgent that Christian churches take seriously this basic Christian understanding of oneness created by Christ, in which people of diverse and different views can actually be transformed into one. And this is the challenge which is even more urgent during our time than any other time. Thank you very much.